Hello, everybody, and welcome to a new episode of When Life Happens. My name is Simone Boersma, and I am the owner of Kinderwijs Gouda, which I founded in 2016 to help and guide children, youngsters, and young adolescents. And today I will speak to somebody who actually does the same. She also guides and helps people, but in a different area of expertise. Leonique van Marel is a grief counselor and a therapist. We speak about grief. We speak about the process of grief and the questions which come up during this period, about judgments and feelings you may have or experience, and about a method she developed together with a colleague, the SHIP method, who is really focused on the grief of divorcement. And of course, we close with the role and the importance of grief counselors. Welcome, Leonique van Marel. You are a grief specialist and therapist. Thank you today for coming. And we're going to talk about grief counseling, about your own practice, and about the meaning of grief and counseling. So thank you. First of all, if I would ask you, how would you define grief?
Okay, that's an interesting question, because when we look it up in the dictionary, it says grief is the reaction we give to a loss. And I think that's correct. But I often talk about this with my clients also, and with people I meet in the field who say, oh, but grief will never pass. And then I say, I'm not sure. It all depends on how you define grief. So for me, I think grief is the most severe reactions you show. And I think the feeling of melancholy about missing the person who died, that will go on forever, maybe. But the real raw feelings, I would define those as grief. But still then, it's still difficult to pinpoint a period in time.
Yeah, I think you also see a lot of differences in coping with grief within your own practice. Can you recall the most severe differences you see?
Absolutely. I think the where it all comes down to, as we notice more often, is the attachment, the way persons are attached from their childhood on. And I think that coping with grief very much depends on your attachment style, as we call it. And then I think I've seen people who are 14 years after losing their child can still not move, sometimes literally. Yeah. And I see people after 1 month after their partner died, they have a new partner. And then, well, of course, we all got judgments about it. But I think it has to do very much with how are you able to provide for yourself? How much do you need someone else in your life to give you all the security and everything that you need? So there's a huge difference in grieving. But on average, I think when we're talking about a partner who died, on average, I think it 2-3 years, and then people are able to live their lives again. When a child dies, an average of 7 years, which also comes from the literature, from investigations. And I think when a father or mother dies, especially when you're young, when you're a child, I think that feeling can go by rather quickly, because children very much live in the here and the now. But they will always miss their parent. I mean, there's like a child cannot be substituted and a parent cannot be substituted. A partner can. And I know that's not nice for people to hear who lost their partners, but it's my own experience also. You can replace your partner because he or she is not a unique person. Well, in itself, he or she is a unique person, but a mother or a child or a father, they're unique in the role they play in your life.
So you would say that it would, with children, it would define their life in a way.
More or less, yes. More or less, yeah, because I think it would define everyone's life. Losing someone who's very close to you defines you and it changes your life. And for children, they will always miss their parents and they will never have, I mean, they can get a very nice stepfather or whatever, but they cannot get their parent. So in that way, in that sense, it defines them, yes.
What's if you guide children, I think you guided also kids who lost their parents in your practice?
Yes, very many, yes.
Many, yeah. How do you guide these kids?
Well, I think what I have in my head is the theory of bereavement. And there are a lot of theories. And I know there's a very old one, which is Elisabeth Kubler-Ross. She talks about emotions. Mm-hmm. That's how I define them. We have the dual process model of Straub and Schut. And they talk about going, switching between loss-oriented goals and recovery-oriented goals. Mm-hmm. But with children, I work along the grief tasks of William Warden. He's an American psychologist. And I do that because the tasks, the model of the theory of tasks, lets us know what we need to do in order to surpass this grief, to be able to cope with this grief. And there are four tasks, and they're not four sessions, there are many sessions. And this is what I do with the children. So I start with realizing what has happened, because children very often do not have all the information, because people think, oh, he knows what it's like, he knows what cancer is, and he knows his father died of cancer. But the child itself is full of questions. Couldn't he have been cured? What is cancer eventually? Why wasn't it discovered earlier? So I work with children very much with really recognizing what had happened and solving all the questions surrounding it. And also to feel really what is the difference in their lives now without the person they lost, and mm-hmm. how was life before. And then with children, they very much also are influenced by the way the adults deal with the loss. So if a father dies, the child also loses its mother. I mean, not forever, but for a short period of time, because mommy is grieving also, mommy is not able to be there for her child. And that's something the children don't understand, because, okay, papa is dead and he's not here, I understand, but my mother is sitting there on the couch and she doesn't do anything. Why not? What am I doing wrong that she's not helping me? So
it's and what are the tools, sorry for interrupting you, what are the tools at that moment? Because that's a significant part in it. Your mother sitting there doesn't do anything, and actually yes. You feel, okay, for the moment, I'm losing now two parents. What yes. is the way of guiding those kids through that point, through that yes. moment?
Well, first of all, it's helping them realize, without me telling them, but helping them realize that it's not their fault. That's one thing. The other thing is, and this is what I see with a lot of children, and also with adults who were children when they lost someone, that they cannot do anything to make mommy happy again. Because I see a lot of issues of powerlessness with adults who were young when they lost someone, because they so much tried to make their mother or their father happy, or that they smiled again, and they did everything and nothing worked. So that's one thing is that they need to realize. And the other thing is, of course, I do the parent consultations also, and I tell the parent what is happening with their child, so they can take that into account. So they can always tell their child, this is not your fault. It's not you because of whom I'm now sad. I'm sad because I miss your daddy. And of course that will pass, but for now I want to cry. And in a few moments I will start cooking. Yeah. So I help the parents help their child also. And I help the children to become stronger from the inside.
Yeah. So found their empowerment again.
Yes.
Is it, I hear you say a lot of children that they found guilty. So the word guilt, did you see it also a lot with adults, or is there a difference in it?
Yes, there's a difference, because I would say I need to be a little bit careful, but I would say that practically every adult would, I'm going to stop my WhatsApp because then it starts coming in. Every adult feels guilty, whether it is someone who died of a disease. They always think, couldn't I have done more? Have I done the right things when they were dying? Should I have? Yeah. So that's even with a disease. So you can imagine what happened if someone suicides. So yeah. What then? All the guilt that they are left behind with, but also heart attack. Did I say the right things? Oh my, he went to his work and I didn't say goodbye. I can never make up for it. We had a row last night and it's my fault that now he's dead. And so much guilt. With children, I see guilt often, but not always. But with adults, practically always. That's really very, very sad, because I say guilt is the most difficult feeling that you can have in bereavement, because there's only one person who can exonerate you, and that's the person who's dead. And of course, the very Buddhist people and Zen people can say, no, you need to forgive yourself. But that's not so easy.
Yeah. So how did they come to that point of forgiving themselves?
Time and very much talking about how it would have been if. And that doesn't help immediately, but we need to get through that story. I mean, whenever they say this to their friends will say, no, it's not your fault. No, you couldn't have done anything. But that doesn't help. So you need to, okay, tell me more. What would it have been like if you have said goodbye? What would be different then now? And would there be something else that you would feel guilty about? You know, there's one thing about guilt. It also helps people to get a feeling of control again. Because in the guilt, we have this sense of, okay, it won't happen again because next time I will make sure I will always say goodbye or I will always do this or that. So it's kind of something we need also to regain control over our lives.
So but it takes a very long time. Would you say that then the social environment of someone is very important at the moment of grief?
Absolutely. And I think that the social environment and the society we live in right now is the reason why I have such a busy practice. Because at first, the first 2 months, people come by, they call, they give you a visit. After 3 months, rarely. After 4 months, everybody does as if it's very normal. And people feel alone in that and they're afraid to burden other people with their story. So they go to a grief counselor.
Yeah. So, and in that, I see a bridge to the method you created, the SHIP method, in that you say it like S-C-H-I-P. Can you tell me a little bit more about that?
Yes, well, it's very interesting. It's very nice that you connect it to grief because SHIP is for people who are getting a divorce. And yes, that's absolutely grief. You know, that's so much grief. And there's so much grief that is not acknowledged because your partner was very bad or he hit you or he or she has another partner. So why should you grieve? Be glad that he's out of your life. But it's grief. It's grief so much. And we it was Tineke Rodenburg and I who created the SHIP aanpak. And it's an acronym for the 5 stages of this method. And it's first, well, it's for people who are getting a divorce to reconnect as parents because they need to disconnect as partners in love and they need to reconnect as parents, as partners in parenthood. And this SHIP method deals with the grief and with everything that was lost during the relationship because a lot of things get lost. I mean, the first time you have an argument with your partner, you think, well, okay, it's not his fault, well, let it go. But then it's still stays inside you and you think, well, he was not so nice at that point. And then 2 weeks later, the same thing happens and you think, oh, there we go again. And when this happens 30 times, the 40th time you think, I'm getting a divorce. I don't want to live with him anymore. Mm-hmm. And then you forget to talk about everything that happened in the past. And that's what's so important because you need to understand why your relationship didn't work out. And you can only understand, just like with bereavement for death, you can only understand if you have all the information. And your partner has the information because your partner can tell you, yeah, but then and that happened. And it was nice. And I didn't say anything about it, but still, it made me feel like la 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 la.
Yeah, because there is a lot, sadly, a lot of divorcement. And that's why I made that bridge. I see it also really as a grieving period.
Yes.
If you made that method, really good method. I studied it a little bit. Do you also participate children within that period of time you guide people?
Well, not when we guide people with the SHIP method. We don't guide the children. At least if I do the SHIP method, I will not guide the children, but my colleagues can guide the children. Mm-hmm. And why? Because the SHIP method is really about the partnership and it's not about the children. And that's what's so new about this method.
Exactly. That's why I say it. It's really something that normally as a therapist, as a pedagogue, you would say, okay, we include the entire family. And with the method you created, it's the opposite, right?
Yes, it is. Because these people need to get to terms with their relationship and not with their children. And a lot of methods say you need to look through the eyes of your children. You need to take their perspective Of course, it's very important. But if you are in stress and if you hate your partner, and you know, love and hate are very, we need this hate also. Eh? We need this hate disconnect to get the detachment. We need this. But if that takes the upper hand, we are not able to think of the perspective of our child, or we say we do. And because of that, we're going to reject the partner. We're going to reject the father or the mother of our children. So you need to first connect with your partner again. And it's always like when you're in a company and you have a fight with your colleague, and your manager comes to you and said, okay, you and your colleague, you're going to guide this couple, or you're going to guide whatever, it doesn't matter. But if you cannot see eye to eye, you can never get there. Yeah. They're so dumb that you say this. So you need to solve the issue that's between the two of you. So that needs to come first. And then you can take the perspective of your child. But then you need, in yourself, you need to feel okay with the fact that the other person gets something. So you need to, it's okay that you get that. It's okay that you see your child. It's okay that, well, all those things. So you need to be more like from a compassionate point of view. Yeah. And when you are in a divorce, and luckily many divorces go okay, but there are also many divorces that don't go okay. And then you don't feel compassionate at all. Then you no, he cannot do that. No, she cannot have him. No, blah, blah, blah. So you act out of revenge. And this is what needs to stop.
Yeah. Then I see out of revenge, you say, okay, you act out of revenge. That's actually one of the stages, anger. If you have a traumatic experience and you need to grieve and you need to pass all these stages. Now, there is also something that can say that is classified under traumatic stress, if you talk about grief, which is say that you have clients in your practice that can be classified under traumatic stress.
Absolutely. And not only with divorce, of course, also with death. But I think that's more obvious. And we can all understand if somebody dies of suicide, that there will probably be a traumatic stress response.
Yeah.
But we also see it in divorce, you know, where someone has been under stress for a very long time and then suddenly is confronted with whatever. They find their partner in bed with someone else. Mm-hmm. Of course, that happens. And then first we need to address the stress. We need to address the traumatic stress. And that can be done with another therapist who can work one-on-one, because the SCHIP method is always with two, with a couple, never one-on-one. But then one of the partners needs to do the stress therapy first before they can go on, because the stress will block your brain. You know, it will block your prefrontal cortex and you cannot think, you cannot analyze.
Well, it's affecting your hormonal system and also neurological. It will be affecting your body. It can even make you ill. So how do you penetrate that part? That you see, okay, now we're going really, we need to get through that stress level. How do you do that?
You mean during the SCHIP method?
Yes.
Yes. Well, then we'll put the SCHIP method on hold, because if we cannot make any progress in the SCHIP method because of that, then we say, okay, we need to take a time out. One of the partners first needs to go to another therapist to do the traumatic stress, to deal with that, so maybe with EMDR, with cognitive behavioral therapy, whatever. And then we go back and we continue the SCHIP method.
Yeah. Okay.
But we beautiful. Do need to take time for that.
Yeah. That's rather important. Otherwise, you can't go ahead.
No, because
also with yourself.
Yeah. And the SCHIP method is very much also about the loss. Yeah? So it's very easy to look at the anger. It's very easy to look at conflicts, but there's so much loss underneath. And that is what needs to be brought to the surface, because there's the conflicts start in the loss. You lose something and it will make you angry, and you will act out of that anger, not out of the loss. And that's where the SCHIP method very much focuses on the loss part. And that when we talk about the loss, both partners have experienced, the conversations go, they get softer, they get more vulnerable, they can better hear each other, and without going like that.
Yeah. So unfortunately, we have globally now COVID-19. A lot of people lost loved ones close by, nearby. Can you tell a little bit about individual grief and about collective grief.
Yeah. So, okay. Well, you asked the question before, how important is our social environment? And it's very important, and especially in grief, where people feel alone and they need the comfort of other people who feel the same grief. So when, for example, you lose your partner, and your partner has a brother, and your partner has a sister, and maybe a mother, and maybe, well, whatever. But you cannot all get together. I mean, maybe for the funeral, if you're lucky, if you were lucky, but not after that, because in the house you can only invite, I think, two people right now. Mm-hmm. So you cannot all get together and share your grief. And sharing your grief is where you feel carried, where you feel that someone supports you. And I hear a lot of grieving people who feel very alone. And of course you can send a WhatsApp and you can call, but it's so different from someone sitting next to you on the couch and not saying a word, but just being with you. So there's so much difference between the individual grief now and not being able to share that collectively. And then let alone what's happening in society. I mean, we are losing so much at this moment. I mean, I had my vaccination yesterday and I was standing in line and it was almost my turn. And I felt the emotions coming up and I had to cry. Not really, but, you know, I was very touched.
Really.
Right. And I thought, what's happening here? And I think this is it. This is my shot to freedom. Taking away your freedom is the worst. And that's what's happened. And we all are very brave to deal with it because we all know that it's needed, but there's a bereavement process going on inside of us. We are losing things, and it starts with acknowledging that this is a situation, but also with acknowledging that it's okay to feel grief, that it's okay to not be okay with this. So it's very hard, and that's because so many people deny those feelings, you get this frustration. I mean, you can all bring it back to the individual grieving process. When somebody cannot air their feelings, they start, they get a short fuse.
Yeah.
And this is what we see in society also. People are fed up and they want to get rid of these nasty feelings. They want to feel free again. So there's a bereavement process going on. And I think we don't talk enough about that. We are only complaining. I mean, you can see when somebody loses his partner, her partner, and she's only complaining, oh, and I feel so bad, oh, and I cannot do, oh, then you're not really connecting with this feeling of loss. And this is what's happening now in society. We are complaining, but we're not saying what we are losing. And this is where we should have our conversations about.
And how do you think we could do that at this point, talking about that loss?
Yes, to ask people, what did you lose because of COVID? What's different for you now? How do you cope? What is it asking of you to be able to cope? How much longer can you cope? What do you need to cope? I mean, the fact
what
that we cannot...
What do you think that most people need to cope with it?
Yeah, well, I think that's where I wanted to get to, because that was happening in my mind also, your question. And I think sports is so important. And to move, to get rid of those frustration feelings. And because of the gyms that are closed, people cannot do that. I mean, okay, children can go to the football courts again, but what do we as adults do? We are bound to, okay, go for a walk. But if you are someone who is used to going to the gym and doing all those, you cannot get rid of these tensions, eh? Like you were talking about traumatic stress.
Yes,
we are all building this up. We're all building it up. And we need to get rid of it.
I want to finish this podcast is with this question. What do you think is the most important thing of grief counseling within the world or within this land?
Okay, the most important aspect of grief counseling, you mean? Yeah, I think it is that we have, that we are curious. I will explain later. Mm-hmm. And that we have attention and that the person who is in front of us can be who they are. So we'll start with that we are curious. I mean, when you're in grief and you're talking to your friends or your family, they all want to solve it. They all want to solve your problem. So they come with some kind of an advice, which maybe mostly doesn't work. And as a counselor, we are always curious. Tell me more about this. How do you feel? what's happening then? Okay, do you have it always? So we try to, by being curious, we invite the other person to get down in themselves to explore what's happening here. What is this about? So that's one thing. The other thing is we have a genuine attention. We are not in a hurry. I have 1 hour time for my clients. I'll be there. It's all theirs. I cannot focus on anything else. It's theirs. I mean, I would say I am the most in the here and the now with my clients because I cannot do anything else. I can only focus on my, I love it. I mean, it's perfect. So the attention, where do they get this attention without somebody, sorry, I put away my phone. You know, it's even when I talk to friends, it's we all have these eye watches or whatever. And I think, okay, I was talking. Why are you paying attention?
I'm really feeling seen.
Really feeling seen. And what was the third thing I said? The third thing. Oh, yeah, they can be who they are. So if somebody cries, if somebody wants to complain, if somebody feels okay, I'm not judging. And I can also not judge because I know how bereavement works. I know that one day you can feel on top of it and the other day you can feel like you want to die. So there is no judgment. So I will never say, last time you were here, you were so good. What happened? No, I will say, okay, tell me more. So I think that's why our work, I mean, is so important also.
Yeah. Well, I totally agree with you. And I think you're doing an amazing job. And people would really need to search for your website. If people type in your name, people type in the name, and then you will find the website of Leonique. So do that, please.
Thank you.
Leonique, I really want to thank you for this conversation. And I really appreciate your openness and everything you told us right now.
Well, thank you for inviting me and good luck.
Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.